Friends, welcome to First United Methodist Church of Plano on this Pentecost season Sunday. I'm Matt Gaston, the lead pastor here. And wherever you are sitting, you are in a church house. And wherever you are sitting, you are connected to hundreds of other church houses in our area and across the United States and even on other continents. This we know. Why do we know this? Because you've taken time to go on our website and register your presence with us this morning to let us know you're there and to give us information that we might maintain this connection of ministry and outreach. So we hope you'll take time to do that. You'll also see a give button there that gives you opportunity to underwrite and undergird the ministries and outreach that we are always busy about. Yesterday, we successfully were a hub for collecting blood in this region for the American Red Cross. We gave over $2,000 and hundreds of pounds of food to Minnie's Food Pantry at a time when they're reaching four times their normal load of persons who are hungry during this pandemic period. Thank you for being partners with us in ministry. As we move through this next week, we've got opportunity to register your children for virtual vacation Bible school, opportunities to grow in faith with two book studies that Reverend Judith Reedy and I separately are leading. There's still time to be part of that. Just, again, look online. But for now, we're connected by a spirit that unites us in one faith, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, as we stand, as we sing, as we praise God. Thank you for being with us this morning.
I invite you to stand and sing with me, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God."
Thank you.
You may be seated.
Good morning. Okay, kids, put your games down and come listen up. And parents, this is very important. Today is the very last day to register for VBS, and your child still receive one of our cool, super awesome Vacation Bible School t-shirts. So please get your children registered today for Vacation Bible School. And kids, it may be summer, but that doesn't mean there's no Sunday school. It means we're in summer Sunday school. So all third through fifth graders and all youth, all the way up through senior high, join us every Sunday morning at 9:45 on Zoom for our Sunday school classes. And our younger ages, you can go to the website to Faith Builders and you'll see your Sunday school class there. So please join us. Our scripture passage this morning is talking about when Jesus was going from city into village and he was going everywhere and he was teaching in the synagogues and he was healing people and he was casting out demons, and there were so many people in need. There were so many that needed what Jesus had to offer. Jesus called the disciples to him, and he asked God to give the disciples all that they needed so that they could go out and do what Jesus was doing in Jesus' name. And they were able to do those things. Today, Jesus is calling us as well to do Jesus' work. We are being called. Now, what can I do, you say? You can use your eyes. And you can look around and see the needs around you. And you can use your ears and listen to maybe a friend who's sad, or call a grandparent who may be lonely and who would love to hear your voice. You can use your mouth to speak words of truth and love with all those around you. We can be the hands and the feet of Jesus. We can be the hands of Jesus by caring for others, helping others. We can share what we have. We can work with our parents and give food to the food pantries, just like we did yesterday with Minnie's. And we can share with those who need the things that we have and that we can give them to help others around us. You can also help your parents at home with whatever they need help with without complaining. Be the hands of Jesus. How can we be the feet of Jesus? We don't have to go far. You can go to your neighbors. You're just somewhere in your neighborhoods. I know that our neighbor across the street recently got out of the hospital, and we're going to cook a meal and take that to her. You may have a flower garden, and you could pick, with your parents' permission, pick some flowers out of your garden and draw a picture or write a note and take it to your neighbor and leave it on their porch. There are so many simple acts of kindness that we can do to be the hands and feet of Jesus in our world today. Vacation Bible School, in a couple of weeks, one of our stations will be missions. And everything that you need will be provided in your mission bag for you to do different things every day to be the hands and feet of Jesus. So as you're going, whatever you're doing, look for those opportunities to share Jesus' love with everyone around you. Will you please say a prayer with me? Dear God, we thank you for calling us by name to serve you and to share your light and your love in this world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Will you pray with me? O God, our healer, hear our cries. Remind us of your compassion for the entire human family. We're in turmoil, We have illness. We're in grief. We have fear. Hear our cry. Encourage, O God, those who continue to be on the front line in so many different capacities, caring for the sick, the disenfranchised, the frightened, the weak. Open our eyes, open our ears, that we may listen and understand with resolve. Heal our world, heal our bodies. Strengthen our hearts and our minds, and in the midst of turmoil, O God, give us your great hope and peace. We pray today that you would hold in your gentle embrace all who have died and all who will die this day. Comfort their loved ones in their loss. Hear our cries, O God. Hold us now in your great love. We pray all these things in the name of the one who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
I invite you to sing, Savior, Like a Shepherd, Lead Us.
Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. I train in thy tender care. In thy pleasant pastures, feed us. Our eyes, thy bowls prepare. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, thou hast bought us, thine we are.
Thank you, Robin. Thank you, Mark Thompson, for some beautiful trumpet accompaniment. We are in the Pentecost season, which means, for this pastor anyway, that each Sunday we're selecting texts out of the common lectionary used by both Protestant churches and Catholic churches alike, so that over time we might cover large swaths of the Bible, both Old and New Testament, that we might not otherwise get to. This week I'll be using a text out of Matthew's Gospel, as will pastors across this country in various forms. Before I get there, though, I would simply share with you that I probably should have seen it coming. My wife, and I've said this about folks anywhere who listen, that when you are coming up to a special birthday, and by that I mean a birthday or an anniversary that ends in a zero or a five, that you ought to be doing something with a little more oomph to it. And so my wife's coming up on one of those this year. It's one of those big birthdays that ends in a zero. I mean, she's going to turn 30. Well, okay. I can either lie or I can lose my marriage. But it's one of those really important birthdays. And so I had, months ago, created plans for her to end in a tropical vacation this summer. And we made these plans back in January, and we're humming along until I get the phone call. Your flight's been canceled. We're not flying there because of COVID-19. Well, great. Okay, we'll reschedule. We'll do it in July instead of June. We good? We're good. Then I get the phone call or text message a week ago. We're not flying in July either. And now I'm thinking, God, are you trying to tell me something here? Especially after the work it took to just get the airline credits back into my bucket so I could use them at a later date. And then I thought I heard, and always have to be careful when you say you're listening to God, but then I thought I heard God perhaps say, look, you've had 3 months of staycation because of the pandemic. What do you want? Well, then I looked at the text. I really dug into the text. And I got kind of convicted by this, because in this lectionary text out of Matthew's Gospel, chapter 9, verse 35, we hear, Jesus traveled among all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, announcing the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and every sickness. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were troubled and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, the size of the harvest is bigger than you can imagine, but there are few workers. Therefore, plead with the Lord of the harvest to send out workers for the harvest. He called his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to throw them out and to heal every disease, every sickness. And here are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, who is called Peter, Andrew, his brother, James, the son of Zebedee, John, his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas, Matthew, the tax collector, James, the Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, Simon, the Canaanite, and Judas, who betrayed Jesus. Jesus sent these 12 out and commanded them, don't go among the Gentiles or into a Samaritan city. Go instead to the lost sheep, the people of Israel. As you go, make this announcement. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those with skin diseases, and throw out demons. You received without having to pay, therefore give without demanding payment. And I read that text and said, okay, Lord, I get it. There is work to do. The vacation can wait. Just listen to the verbs that the writer uses in that short text. Jesus travels. He is teaching. He is announcing, he is having compassion, he is pleading, and he is sending out his workers for the harvest. Now, I have no doubt that Jesus knew how to take care of himself, what we like to call self-care these days. We know that Jesus spent time with his disciples. He took them away to a quiet place for prayer and regeneration. We know that he spent time with his friends, Mary, Martha, and their friend Lazarus. Two sisters and a brother spent time at their home, sort of recharging his batteries. We know that he took time out. But we also know that Jesus was laser focused in what was essentially 3 years of ministry. It's fairly commonly agreed that he was executed before his 34th birthday. He knew he had a work to do and a limited amount of time to do it, so he was laser focused. There was work to do. And as I read this text and as I have thought about what is going on in the world around us, and as I see what is happening even in the church with which I have the privilege of serving, I'm becoming convicted that there is work to do. I've come upon a term that I've heard used more and more in the common vernacular these days, and I was curious about it, so I looked it up. The phrase is an inflection point. And so I looked it up. And an inflection point, first, is a mathematical term. It is the point, think a sine wave mathematically. An inflection point is that place at the high point where it changes from ascending to descending. Or it gets to the bottom or the trough and it stops from descending and begins to ascend. Those are inflection points. In business, an inflection point is when a business cycle is changing. We've experienced it nationally as we have gone from 14 years of a bull market and an expanding economy. We hit an inflection point, and now we are definitely in the first stages of a recession. There was a tipping point, an inflection point, right there in that March-April timeframe. As it's being used now, an inflection point is a shift in direction of a stream of history. That's my definition. That which we have always known to be true is now suddenly and unexpectedly changing. I believe that the Spirit is blowing across this land. I believe the Spirit is blowing across the globe in the midst of this pandemic season. And people are responding in ways that they couldn't have expected, didn't see coming, but find themselves nonetheless nudged, called, pulled, motivated to respond in ways that collectively and organically is creating an inflection point. This isn't the first time that's happened. The Catholic Church was going along just fine historically until Martin Luther tacked 95 theses on a door in the Wittenberg Church in Germany. He wanted reform. What he got was a reformation. It was an inflection point in Christian history. There was a fork in the road that would not be stopped, a movement that Martin Luther saw was necessary in order to give power not just to priests, but also to people, to empower them with Scripture, to be about the calling that God was putting on their lives by virtue of their baptism. 200 years later, John Wesley, the loyal Anglican priest, was told by his bishop, "You stay within your parish, that is your boundary." And Wesley famously said, "No, the world is my parish." And he began breaking the rules to go out to the people who couldn't afford to be in churches on Sunday, people in coal mines, people in open fields, and he began to preach and to tell them about Jesus and that their lives were every bit as valuable as any of the genteel English people of which he was part. No, it was an inflection point in history. And when he authorized Thomas Coke and Francis Asbury to come over to the colonies soon to become the United States, he authorized them to offer them Christ. And like Jesus, Thomas Koch and Francis Asbury realized they needed the people, and the people needed them. Just as Jesus needed his disciples, and the disciples needed him, they got about to organizing. And they organized in such a fashion that they equipped people where they were in their homes. For there were no churches to speak of. He authorized them in their homes to be house churches. And they equipped those in homes because there was such a shortage of trained clergy. And as happened at Pentecost, so happened in American religious history. A movement was born. And as Christianity spread from the East Coast to the West Coast during the 19th century, historians give those Wesleyans, those Methodists, credit for being the ones who were most equipped to take the good news of Jesus Christ to people wherever a new settlement popped up. Why? Because they met people where they were. And they were filled with such an urgency that there was work to do. There was no time to waste. And they equipped the people to go and do what Jesus had done. To feed, to teach, to heal the sick, to cast out demons, to console, and to bring justice where there was injustice previously. And to affirm that by the grace of Jesus Christ in every person's creation and baptism, they were a person of sacred worth. And Methodism in the 19th century was a movement. The leaders today of churches around are sensing that there is once again a movement. That just as Jesus organized his disciples, sent them out, died, visited them again in the upper room, ascended, sent them out, visited them again by way of the Holy Spirit, organized them and sent them out, so the people of God are feeling a fresh blowing of the Holy Spirit. There is a sense of urgency. There is a sense of purpose. There is a sense of we cannot wait and we cannot waste time. When all of us who are United Methodist pastors are ordained, we stand before the bishop. And the bishop asks all of us, standing in front of him or her, and standing in front of often 1,000 people in attendance, the historic questions that Wesley asked his ministers over 200 years ago. And amongst those questions is this. Wesley asked, and the bishops ask today, will you observe the following directions? Be diligent. Never be unemployed. Never be triflingly employed. Never trifle away time. Neither spend any more time at any one place than is strictly necessary. Be punctual. Why was Wesley so concerned about how we use our time? Because there is work to do in this world. And it is of such importance that we be light, that we be salt, that we be food to a world that is hungry for change. And he was about equipping persons in their church homes to be precisely that, just as surely as Jesus was equipping his disciples to go be light, salt, bread to a hungry world. I believe that there is a fresh spirit blowing across this land and blowing across this globe that is spontaneous and it is spiritual. And I believe that folks are finding themselves rising up when they never thought they would ever rise up because they too are looking for light, they're looking for salt, and they're looking for bread that matters in a way that feeds others in a just way and raises everyone's boats. In a way that pulls people together in common cause. And I don't know where that's going to go. None of us do. But if this is truly of the Spirit, we can only be faithful in following its nudging, following its leading, because there is work to do in this world. What I do know is that last Sunday, when I spoke on a flatbed trailer, there were 3,500 people at downtown Plano, and maybe 60% of them were black, but 30 to 30% were white and another 10% were brown and olive, and everybody there was hungry for change. I think it might be a movement of the Spirit when 1,000 people march because Black Lives Matter, organized by a 19-year-old in South Lake, Texas, a senior from Carroll High School, organizes 1,000 people to march to proclaim that they too are hungry for change. 500 people march in Vidor, Texas. Vidor, Texas, a known location in decades past for the Ku Klux Klan. 500 people in Vidor, Texas, marching to say that Black lives matter and are hungry for change. And it's not just happening in Texas. It's not just happening across the United States. It's happening in Europe. It is happening in Australia. It is happening in places in Africa. This blowing of the Spirit is global. And I believe there is an urgency that does not afford us, any of us, to trifle away time, but to be responsive and to be hopeful and to be prayerful about that which the Spirit is doing for all lives who have been marginalized, all sexes who have been marginalized, for all persons of need who have been marginalized. A Spirit is blowing, and there is work to do. I know it because I have seen it happening within our very church. The way our people have responded in this pandemic period, the mass of collections of food to feed the hungry in our mission field, the number of people who are sewing masks, some who had never sewed before, some of them male, have picked up and learned a pattern and taken a sewing machine and sewed masks to donate and give to frontline workers or anyone else who needs a mask. We have donated blood. We have stepped out and given beyond ourselves for the sake of ministry in this field. We have run errands for people. We have bought food for people. We have run them to doctor's appointments and taken them back home. We have mobilized in ways that nobody remembers having done before. In fact, four persons have said to me and to others, I have felt closer to my church because of this time of social distancing. The care and the grace and the compassion and the following up, I have felt closer to this church than I ever have. That's got to be something of the Spirit. No, I don't think I have time to take a vacation right now. There is too much work to do to organize our church, to retrain our church, to open our minds to new ways of doing ministry that we're already doing and can't go back on. To imagine what church already is in your church home and what you are already doing in your neighborhood and how to connect us in ways that are prioritized by the needs of the world and the grace given to us by God through Jesus Christ. To truly live into our vision statement of connecting God and grace to self and to community. Now there's work to do. And if the death of George Floyd on the ground can move a world to action, how much more can a church be moved to action by the death of Jesus Christ on the cross? I don't know, but I am eager to find out. This is the good news. May we hear it and live it. Amen.
As we come to the time of gifts and offering, the words found in the book of Acts, chapter 17, come to mind. God gives to all mortals life and breath and all things, so that in God we live and move and have our being. God, the giver of all good gifts. So our offering today and always is an act of love. to the giver of all good gifts. Thank you.
Please rise and sing with me, "Here I Am, Lord."
Shall I send? Here I am.
You know, God is calling. The Spirit is blowing. The only question is, how will each of us respond? Worthy of our prayer and our reflection in this Pentecost season. Receive this benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion and the fellowship and the movement of the Holy Spirit be yours now and forevermore. And the whole church said, Amen.